So that was a good testimony. Anyway, having a supernatural encounter with his presence and the desperate need that we have to have that in our lives. And you see, I want us to understand that we live in a day today that we're afraid of the word supernatural. We're afraid of the word fire. We're afraid of all the things that really work. How many know that 30 years ago, there was the true fire of God? How many know that many years ago, there were true encounters of Almighty God? There was no phony staff. There was nothing like that. But now we live in a day that there is a fake fire, fake encounters, fake manifestations, fake this and fake that. So in the midst of all the fake, I believe that I cannot avoid of talking about the true encounter and talking about the true fire of God. If the devil has made it to confuse people, I tell you the truth will always set people free. So what I'm after today is talking about the true fire, the true encounter with God, because I have many encounters with the Lord. I have many, and we have to understand the encounters that we have with God, the encounters that we have in his presence. How many of you, sometimes Jesus, in your walk with him, he blew your mind? Amen? We can all say that at some point in our Christian walk, Jesus blew our mind. So that means that we had a supernatural encounter. We had a visitation. We had an encounter with his presence. Something that made us more than just believers. Now we knew that he's real. I remember when I first became a Christian, I wanted to seek God, and I went to a farm outside of Toronto. I wanted to pray, and I wanted to fast. So I called this Baptist fellow there, and I said, "Sir, I said I'd like to come to your farm, and I want to spend the weekend there, and I want to I want to fast and pray and whatever God has for my life." And he said, "Okay." And then when I got there, listen to this: when I got there, I couldn't stay at the farm. He was working at the farm. And there was no furniture in the farm. And he was renovating the farm. And my balloon was burst. Because I did not arrive there to spend time at his house. I arrived there to spend time in the farm. Amen? So I looked at the barn. It was a big barn there, but there was no light there. Then I look at the farm here, and so I say, "Lord, I'm not going to his house tonight. You're going to have to make a way for me to stay here." And when I stayed there, I began to help him carry some stuff for him and all of that. In those days, I was 145 pounds, just coming out of the world, skin bones. I don't miss that. And I'm helping him. And all of a sudden, on the second floor window, I see a demon peeking. God opened my eyes to see a devil looking out the window. You know, and they were Baptists. I didn't want to ruin their day and say, there are devils in there. You know, so then I start thinking. I said to him, I say, "Is there a light in the house? Because I made my mind to sleep in the house." Right? And then I began to see more devils there. They were afraid. They were not happy. They were not trying to scare me, because they must have seen something around me or something around the house that they haven't seen for a while. And they must have said, "God is up to something here this weekend, boys." And I was a young Christian. You know, I didn't know too much about the Romans road and about Genesis to Revelation. I knew my knowledge of the Word of God was limited. But from that date, I always liked the challenge. So if there's devils there, Let's go at it. Because I already knew that Jesus was real. Jesus came into my life. I knew that greater was he in me than he that is in the world. So I saw all of that. I already had some experiences in the streets of Toronto before that. So I was already living from encounter to encounter. But this one here, then I said, okay, Lord, I'm going to sleep there. So anyway, to make a long story short, then they left. And they say, you crazy for you to sleep here. And I said, no, I came here to spend time with God here. And this is where I'm going to stay. And I had those big ghetto blasters. Remember those ghetto blasters? Yeah. With the cassette players? Yeah. So I had one of those ghetto blasters. And I was sitting outside. I said, sooner or later, I got to go inside and face whatever is there. Because the Lord revealed to me before I got in there that home was demon possessed. And the people that lived there were alcoholics, wife beaters, and all of this stuff. So it was not a pleasant thing. But God wanted me to go to the jungle in there. And so I was playing these Christian songs outside. And I was trying to get some strength, you know, because in those times I didn't have Pastor Ralph or anybody around me. It was just me and Jesus. So how many times, how many of you know that you and Jesus is enough? Amen. And we have to realize that. We have to stop, you know, thinking that we need others for what God wants to do, right? So then I gained my strength, and then I didn't shut it off because I needed some companion, right? And I took that ghetto blaster inside. And before that, I put my sleeping bag on the floor, and there was only one light in the place. And I lay down on that carp and the sleeping bag. And I had the ghetto blaster here. And I said, well, sooner or later, I got to turn these things off. And you know, when you have an empty room and then you turn off, then there is a buzz. And the moment that I turned it off, I saw about 20 demons in front of me. Just standing. They looked like burned creatures. Okay, they were not spirits. They were devils. You know, the Bible talks about that demons, they walk, right? Spirits, they fly. So I saw about 20 of them there. And I say, oh my God. Right? And there was a spirit here that I couldn't see. That wanted to be there. That if I gave in to fear, then he will probably wanted to come in. But he couldn't come in, of course, because I was in that time possessed by the Holy Ghost. And then what I did, I started praying. And they will move out of the way, and they will go on high, and then they will come back again. Then I will pray in the name of Jesus again. They will move, and they were not happy campers. They were afraid. And that's why I encouraged, because I was able to see their faces. I was able to see their countenance on their faces, and they were not happy. Why? Because God is bigger than them, and they know it, right? So then I did that a couple of times, and I said, Lord, something's wrong over here. So I says, in Jesus' name, they got to go, and they're not going. So at one point in that evening, I felt to put my hands on my eyes, and I went down on the floor, and I couldn't see anything. I don't know how long I was with my eyes closed, putting my eyes, and when I got up, everything was clear, and a thick cloud filled that place. The presence of God has invaded the room. And then after that, I shared that thing with somebody. And he said to me, he says, well, the Lord could not manifest when your eyes were open because he would have blinded you. So he said, he probably, you cover your eyes and maybe he took you out of the room and then got those devils out of that place and set that home free so those Baptist people can come and live happily ever after. And I says, you know, but that was an encounter with the Lord. Right? And you see, I cannot live with an encounter from 39 years ago. And a lot of Christians today, that's what they're doing. They're living with encounters of yesterday. And that's the reason, you know, when you're living in the encounters of yesterday, so many years ago, at some point we feel like we run out of gas, and then we become complacent, we become with apathy, we become dead, we become lukewarm, and then what happens? We lose the fire. Am I talking to the right people today? Amen? I remember another time. I was a young Christian as well. Remember, I told you a couple of weeks ago, 5 years I was flying. God was just doing, and we're going to understand why he flies more for others. Because the reason that God gives us encounters with him is according to the calling of God upon your life. I remember, you know, we were praying about, I don't know, 8 of us in a home. I was a young Christian. Now I have some Christian friends and all of that. And then in the midst of the prayer, someone came into the room. A heavenly creature came into the room, and I was pulled to kneel before this creature. And as I knelt before this creature, I began to weep for about 20 minutes or so. The people that were watching them, they freaked out because they haven't seen anything like that. And I believe that the Lord himself or some heavenly creature came and said, Johnny, come here. I'm going to fill you with me. And, you know, and those are encounters that we have. But that was 38 years ago. You see, after all those years, I have failed God. I have obeyed God. I have gone through my ups and downs and all of that. But I was able to sustain, and God sustained me through the good times and the bad times. And those revelations, those encounters really helped me. Because if I didn't have that, and I the only thing that I had is promises by Christians around us, and by good preaching from the pulpit, but no encounters of the presence of God or anything like that, then sooner or later we're going to die. And that's where a lot of people in the church are, dead. You see, we don't want people in churches to come and be entertained. Many people in churches and leaders' knowledge has become an idol. Because they have become content with knowledge. Not with experience. You see, the devil will always ruin something that works. The devil has ruined money. The devil has ruined the fire of God. The devil has ruined the visitation of God. The devil has ruined what the Holy Spirit can do. So he has created false things so that way the church don't touch that which works. So knowledge has become an idol because they have become content with knowledge, not with experience. They have come to church to hear something new, but not to experience something new. We become satisfied with knowledge than knowing God or experiencing God. What will keep you fighting, obeying him, is your experience with God. You see, what's keeping me fighting for this region, what's keeping me fighting is my daily experiences with the Lord. Not weekly, not monthly, but daily. Not because you say, well, how come you get in the daily and I'm just getting it once a month? It's because maybe it's the call. We're going to get to that. Sometimes God gives you more for, you know, the Bible says to him that has more, given more, much will be required. So that means that if the call of God is such, then God will give you the experiences with him as such. But God doesn't deal like that with everybody, that you're not going to go and see devils. Because if some of you have seen devils, man, you will have a heart attack maybe. I don't know, right? But I didn't, right? So, so doesn't mean that I'm better than you. Is that I'm going to suffer maybe more than most. Many years ago, my wife said to me, she says, the way I see you is like what God said to Paul. I'm going to show him how much he has to suffer. Because we went through a great suffering. And that is part of the callings of God upon somebody's life. But there are different levels. There are different callings. So we can't compare. And we talked about this about 2-3 weeks ago. We cannot compare ourselves with somebody else. Be happy that somebody else is probably getting more than you. Because if you're complaining about your situation and your trials, be happy that you don't have his trials. Because if you have his trials, you will have a huge trial bigger than what you're facing today. There is a price to pay for the callings of God upon somebody's life. Amen? Most of the religious in the world offer knowledge, not an experience with God. We must have an experience with God, an encounter with Him. The Bible is full of those that have experienced God as they encounter God. The only experience that some people have is when they go to a place where the power of God is manifested. When they enter and they feel the awesome power of God. And a lot of them do. You know, they go to a church, oh, I felt the power of God there. But it's not, are you feeling the power of God there? But are you feeling the power of God in your life, in your home, in your marriage, in your relationships? Are you feeling the power of God in your home? Because the power of God is not meant to be felt only in the churches, but the power of God. Oh, I want to go to the church because the power of God is there. Shame on you. The power of God should be in you. So when you come to church, the power of God in the church corporately is greater because your power is putting something extra to the service. Tradition will block the power of God. And that is one of our main problems in this region. I cannot speak about Canada because every time I go to Toronto, I get nothing from the Lord. God does not want me to be distracted. But God has revealed things in this region. My biggest battle in this region as a person of God is not that God cannot heal. The biggest problem in our region is a tradition of people. Tradition in the church. We have become worldly. We have allowed the world to come in. We have become proud and cocky. I tell you, I'm asking God to destroy the pride and the arrogance in people's life and to blow them out or to blow them in as they repent and they come and serve a true God. Tradition blocks the power of God. Theology. Without an experience with God is nothing. I know people that have read this Bible more than I have. And they have died without knowing the person in the Bible. I'm sure that some of you know that too. Because theology, knowledge, principles in the Word of God does not save a person. We cannot read the Word just because, okay, we're going to read about God. God did not die for us to know about God. The religious know about God. The Muslims know about God. The Jewish nation know about God. God is not after people knowing about Him. God is after about people knowing Him personally. Hallelujah. Knowing His presence. Knowing His power. So theology is nothing, even though it's important for us to know the Word. But it's worth nothing if you have no experience the presence of God and the power of God. Because when you become alive, then your theology and your principles of the Word of God become life. Because truth with experience is more powerful than truth alone. God is speaking tonight. You can have the knowledge about Jesus as a Savior. But it's worth nothing if you don't experience Him as a Savior. You can know Him about Him being a deliverer. But you will probably never experience Him as your deliverer.
Those in the Bible had a continuous experience with God. And I told you something that happened 30 years ago. And the reason I don't tell you about what happened this week and last week and the week before is because some of you will get angry and get mad at God because, oh God, how come you giving him so much goodies to him and not to me? Shame on you. If you want more goodies, get on your knees, fast, pray, or go to a room and don't come out of that room until heaven comes down. Your jealousy and your complacency and your complaints is making you dead, and you begin to smell dead around God's people. There is a stink in some of those that profess to be Christian. They're all talk and no action. And we're going to get there in a minute. Many are relying on an experience from years ago. As I said, we need a fresh encounter with God. And I pray that God will give you a fresh encounter tonight and tomorrow and next day and next day and next day, so that you can come just like Brenda did last week or the week before and say, man, Pastor John, I need to talk to you. God came through Saturday. God came through Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. And she called me on Thursday and she says, now I'm amazed at what God is doing. Here is a simple lady experiencing God. And some of us, we think that we're superheroes. And you're not experiencing God. You smell rotten. You see, how are we going to overcome the blindness and the problems and the traditions is by speaking the way I'm speaking now? For too long we have preached a soft message. My son knows that when I tell him a strong message, he knows that I'm in business. That is either this way or that way. There is no other way. And if we're going to be a people of God and a people of truth, we better start speaking like Jesus is.
You can have proper theology about Jesus but never experience God or not living with a continuous encounter. Many believe that God is a God of miracles. The question is, are you experiencing any miracles? Are you seeing any miracles? Forget about seeing miracles in YouTube. Are you seeing miracles in your home? Are you seeing miracles in your marriage? Are you seeing miracles in your own life? How come the Holy Spirit that rose Jesus from the dead dwell in us and has not experienced God in our lives? And why do we need an encounter and experience with God? Many are afraid. We live in those days. If I have to connect with the preacher now, I have to do a background check on the preachers to see if they're in the truth or not, to see if they're in the true fire or not, to see if they're the true manifestation of the Spirit or not. And I tell you, half of them are not. Those are the days that we live in now. Our only salvation as preachers and our leaders is to tell the truth the way God wants it to teach. That's your salvation. That's your safe net.
So many are afraid of the word, at the word experience or encounters, because deception has started, especially in the days that we live in, as I mentioned. But as I mentioned earlier as well, we cannot stop going after the true fire and the true manifestation of the Spirit of God. I am not stopping. I understand that we as leaders, we might protect the body, the sheep, from such things. And I agree fully. A lot of the things out there are poison to the body of Christ. Many have no experience with true God. Maybe they have not seek him. Maybe they don't have the truth. and they only went after an experience, and the Bible teaches us that. Truth with spirit. John chapter 4, verses 23 and to 26, but the hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. And for the Father seeks that kind of people. Amen? So it's not only a spirit, but truth, because truth will keep you intact, will keep you in the truth. The Bible says that the spirit of truth will guide you to all truth, will tell you what is yet to come. So we have to play safe. But we cannot stop of going after the fire of God, having an encounter with Him. Getting into a room and don't come out until you see heaven loose upon your life. We must provoke one another to go after all that God has and is. I love what I do on the radio. Because the Holy Ghost is provoking people in this region through the radio to get right with God, to get back to God, to seek God with all of their hearts, mind, and soul, to love Him above all things. So we must provoke each other than to help each other stay in the misery that we live in. I remember, here's another one. When I first became a Christian, I will pick the homeless people out there, and I will bring them to my place without asking my parents to sleep there. They thought that I was nuts, right? But they went along with it because it was better for their son to be here than to be out there getting drunk and not knowing what he was doing. And the only thing that they saw is me getting into my room and playing Christian music when I should have been out there in the bars and the discos dancing and being with my friends and all of that. I was in my room glorifying God. But in that place, as I was glorifying God, listen, God is my witness. When I began to praise God as a young Christian, listen to this, the glory of the Lord visited that room. There was a cloud in that room that I was not able to see the pictures on the wall. The Bible says that we should live from glory to glory. And here we see Martha doing. Busy. Serving is good, but many do things so they feel good for their identity. We cannot do things so people like us. In God, everything starts with being, and then you do. Brother John, I'm a prophet. Show me your fruits. Brother John, I'm an apostle. Show me your fruits. Show me how many dead you have raised. How many people are you impacting every week? Or are you just talk but no action and no fruits? So show me how many people are following you. How many people are you discipling? Show me how many churches you have planted. An experience or encounter with God will eliminate that pride and deception. And the closer we get to God, His light shines and darkness leaves. People are doing and doing and talking and talking. Are you doing because you are or because of makes you feel good? Are you serving people because you are a priest, a child of God, a fighter for God's people? Are you fighting for them or are you fighting just to look good? Martha was cooking a meal that Jesus will never eat. God is not interested in your hot wash. Come on. We have a lot of nice hot wash. I'll go wherever you want me to go. Yeah, really. We're great in talking. We're going to get to that, and we're going to close soon. So don't run away. Mary chose to have an encounter with God, with His presence. We cannot give what we don't have. If the only thing that we have is works, we have not much to give. But if we live in the presence of God and He walks with you and talks with you and tells you you are His own, then you live in His presence. Then you are full with Him. The Bible says in Psalms 23, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. But then He says, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. That means I will dwell in the presence of God forever. Then we have something to give. When we go and give to others, we don't give them knowledge, but only we provoke them to have an encounter with God. A people of power, listen to this. A people of power will remove religion. And provoke people to encounter God. I say that for many years, religion is dead. But we have so many religious people now in our circles. In Pentecostal churches, in evangelical churches, we have so many people in religion, religious tradition. That's why Paul says, I came to give you some good news. I taught you well and all of that. And what in the world happened to you? Who in the world has bewitched you? And I'm sure there's somebody there in the group that say to Paul, who are you to call us that we are bewitched? And I say, and Paul probably said, show me your fruits. Show me your fruits. You want God to speak to you? You think that you're a great person of God, those that are sitting here and hearing in the word? Look at the fruits. What fruits are you producing? Or are you living in a dead tree that you produced 10 years ago or a year ago? Religion is the absence of the power of God. Because when the power of God hits a person, religion must flee. Religion, I'll say it again, is the absence of the power or encounter with God. Some of you, you had an encounter with God and you were good. But some of you have become so religious. And all you do is complain about how hard and how bad things are. If you're going to speak about how hard and how bad things are, you better be living from glory to glory, because then your truth coming out of your mouth will be from the Holy Ghost and preaching the truth when you have fruits in your life. People go to church, Pentecostal church, Baptist church, Wesleyan church, evangelical, born again believers, tongue talking, so-called devil chasing, that I need to see. They go to church and they go back to a worldly life during the week. Cursing, drinking, smoking, sleeping around, and all of these things. How in the world can we profess to be Christians when we allow the devil in the week grips us into the things of the world? When you have an encounter with God, you know that there is no other way but to be holy as He is holy. When you have an encounter with God, the light shines, and the closer you get, that light shines brighter and expels darkness. You don't want sin anymore. You want holiness. You want to live for Him and please Him no matter what. That's what's happening in your life, Robert. I'm reading the Bible more. I'm praying more. I'm more aware of the Spirit of God is doing something in people's life when they want more than the ordinary, when they're tired of the way they used to live. Oh, hallelujah. We should get tired of the misery of the life that we have and continue to complain and complain and complain and complain for years. Thinking that we're better than other people. Shame on you. May the Lord bring you down. As he brought me down. Oh, he brought me down, all right. The whole city of Toronto knew that Johnny was dead out of service. And when everybody thought that I was dead out of service, God took me to a wilderness. He didn't talk to me for 8 years. In those 8 years, he dealt with me. He destroyed so much in my life that when he brought me back, I tell you, I went back to Toronto. And when they saw me there, they said, "Wow, he's alive." So you want to be more holy, more righteous. Supernatural. Supernatural means this: above, outside, off. Super means above, outside, off. Natural means creation. So we can say the life that we live is above creation. Is above the natural. She'll be above the natural. I'm not conformed to this world. I'm not to conform to the world, to the government of this world, and to the system of this world. My government is from heaven. We are seated in heavenly places. You need a job, you need healing, you ask. You are sitting there. You are not of this world. Your right is all that heaven has and can afford. We are completing him. Your heavenly pattern is heaven. There is no sickness there. There is no devils there. Let your kingdom come now. We are called to live above, outside the natural. I see it in my own life. I never knew that God will ever call me to be a troublemaker in the HRM. But I understand that I'm living above the natural. This is not something that the mind of man can come up with. But this is something that only God can anoint and God can release to a region. Where there was a lack of the word of God, there was a lack of the presence of God. A region full with religious people and with a people that have not encountered God for years. You live outside the negativity of this world. We have more negative people, I tell you. And you get around some people that are so negative that when you get out from there, man, that cloud of darkness just follows you. My God, it's so thick. And they call themselves Christians. They live in negativity, always complaining and all of that. What is a sign? That is a sign that they have no fruits and a sign that they need a fresh encounter with Almighty God. The devil will keep you living there. He wants you to keep you in his world, a world of sin, a world of sickness, a world of devils and all they have to offer. But you need to live above that, above the natural. And you need to know that you are seated in heavenly places. Encounters, as I close, are found when people fast, pray, seek God with all of their hearts. Because that's when we catch the attention of Almighty God. As I mentioned to the leaders, and as I mentioned to people over the years, how in the world can we say, you know, that people need to get back to their knees when we are not getting back to our knees? Now the question is this: did Jesus promise that we shall all have an encounter with him? John chapter 14, verse 21. He who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father. And I will love him and manifest myself to him. Is it for some or for all? God wants to manifest himself in your life and blow the socks out of you. Because he's good at that. Two conditions to reveal himself to you. Number one, you got to love him. Number two, you got to obey his commandments. Manifest is the same word in Mark 16:14. He appeared to them, the Bible says. He manifested himself to them. It's the same word. He revealed himself to them. One of the prayers that I always pray and encourage you to pray, he says, Lord, fill me with the spirit of revelation. That when I go to church, I can close the Bible and the Spirit of God will manifest himself and begin to speak life into my spirit. Than to be distracted. Come on. Christianity must start with a revelation of him. Then we go to repentance, baptism, receiving the Holy Ghost, all of that good stuff. Many people in church have never had an encounter with God. They sing and dance. But when you have a revelation of him, your life will never be the same. People are used to come to church to learn principles only, not the person. Today we are trying, listen, this is the word of the Lord. Today we are trying to change people with principles. Fill this place with young people and try to change them with principle. Young people and old people, they don't want to see only principles. They want to see the fruit of those principles. They want to see a manifestation of the Spirit of God and the power of God. Yes, we believe in principle and we teach it. But if we don't deal with the heart of the person, we can teach all the principles that we want. But when that person has an encounter with God, his power, his presence, and a revelation of who he is, then it will be easier for a person to obey him. I'm approaching a few people in our group soon that I see that they didn't have an encounter. They're doing what Jesus called us to do, but they haven't left the world. First Samuel chapter 16, verse 7. For the Lord sees not as man sees. For man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. You can say, Brother John, I go to church Sunday after Sunday, weekday after weekday, but there is no change in me. Well, what you need is a fresh encounter with Almighty God. We cannot grow a ministry with principles alone. We must provoke people to have an encounter with God. As I mentioned, I will dwell in the house of the Almighty forever. Every person has that is called of God had a supernatural experience. They had an encounter with God. They had, and listen to this, they had a passion to what God called them. Listen to this word. I'm going to throw it from the Spirit. Some of you think that you're called. But where in the world is your passion for that call? Because if you have the passion, you wouldn't stop until you do it. They had a passion for it. And listen to this. This one you won't like, but it's part of the package. They had a passion for it, for whatever God called them to, and even a passion to suffer. A passion to die for him. Some of you, you say that God has called you and you won't even roll up the sleeve and get dirty. He went on the floor. He washed people's feet. And we're not willing to get dirty. Shame on us. I got a couple people mad on the internet when I put a posting about the gospel of prosperity. Man, somebody was following me for a long time and they got mad and they repost something on my thing. He hasn't heard what I'm going to preach 2 weeks, 3 weeks from now. God is giving me a revelation that will block your socks off. It will block the church's socks off because there is such a deception with the gospel of prosperity and many have swallowed that thing. Money has become the god of many people in the church. If you don't have income tax receipts, I'm not giving you any money. That's not for you to hear. So God, if God has called you, where in the world is your passion? Where is your passion to suffer? Where is your passion to die for him? You want to take the radio program for a couple of weeks and let her loose so that way you understand what kind of passion we should have, that we should be, have a passion to be unpopular, to be unliked, to be hated. Some people are afraid to click a like on my postings because they don't want to be associated. Then you go to churches that their pastors, they tell you, oh, he's out of the will of God. Keep away from him. But you still go to a person like that. A person that is not fighting me, but is fighting the truth of the word of God. Jeremiah. Give me a couple minutes. 28:9. He went through a hard time. Listen to Nehemiah. He was about to give up. He says, I will not make mention of him, nor speak anymore in his name. I've been there. A few years ago, I resigned. I said, God, I don't want to serve you anymore. I'll go to a church and help somebody, but no. This is not the way it should be. You got to do it my way. So he says, I will not make mention of him, nor speak anymore in his name. But his word was in my heart like a burning fire shut up in my bones. I was weary of holding it back and I could not. Why did I survive 8 years of hell? Why did I survive all those years? It's because the word of God is like a burning fire within me. Abraham was called by an audible voice. Jacob through a dream. Joseph through a dream. Moses with the burning bush. Why? Listen, because the last generation, they saw first, then they acted. This generation must be different. We must act, then see. Even though there was no sign of a flood, Noah began to build the ark to see the impossible, to see the hand of God, that he will reign for 40 days and 40 nights. and he will destroy the world, as he said.
But a lot of people are still living in the Old Testament, wanting to see first, then act. No, the new generation, the new breed of Almighty God, you need to act first, then see. Faith without work is dead. God said to Joshua, every place that you put your foot at, that becomes your possession. So he had to act first to see. When I went to the Citadel Hill, I didn't have nothing. The only thing I had is somebody that said, oh, we should go to the Citadel Hill and pray there. Let's do it. I didn't know how I'm going to do it. So first we act, then we see. God will manifest himself to you in accordance with his calling upon your life. Then he will give you a passion, a fire for it, and you will be very productive in that. The greater the calling, the greater the trials. In order for you never to give up during those trials is to already have an encounter with God and living above the natural. Paul says, count it all joy when you fall into divers temptation, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience, and let patience have a perfect work in you, that you may come to the place of desiring nothing. The encounters I have brought me to where I am now. And now I need more encounters with God to take me where he's taking me. Paul said, I did not come with principles, but I came with power. And I close with this. This is the third time and I mean it. Mary criticized those with encounters. And they even kill those that have it or had it. Many today criticize encounters, afraid of deception. But who is the one that is deceived? The one that criticizes it, or the one that has it? Paul had it. Brother John had it. Do you have it?